Hello, good morning to everyone. Very warm welcome on behalf of our WG1 group. We are just waiting a few seconds before starting. But then we have to be very strict on time because we have three wonderful presentations today. Yeah, just for those who have not met yet, my name is Virag, Zsar, and I'm working for HÉTFA Research Institute, and I will moderate this session today, as I have been with our nice colleague, Edwin Kanters, the co-leader of WG1 in the prolongation of BESTPRAC. So now I see that there are more than 100 people, so no pressure at all to my speakers. But let's start, let's jump in. As I said, we have three wonderful presentations, we have three wonderful speakers, and the first will be Anna Raask, who is currently Senior Research Advisor at the Royal Institute of Technology. And basically, she has wonderful experience with related to large-scale cooperative projects within Pillar 2 of Horizon 2020 and Europe. And she's very much experienced in the topic of impact, drawing impact pathways, and so on. Basically, I could list her wonderful and huge track record, but I will not take much of her time. There is 15 minutes for her presentation, and after that, we will have two, three questions that you are asked to share in the chat, and I will read it out. So now, Anna, the floor is yours. Good morning. We're very happy to have you here.
Oh, thank you. Thanks for those kind words. And lovely to be here, obviously. I've been involved in BESTPRAC-EARMA previously and always happy to be part of it and your activities. So my name is Anna Raask. I work as a senior research advisor at the research support office at KTH in Sweden, in Stockholm. And I work mostly, as it was mentioned, with large cooperative projects, obviously the Pillar 2 projects, and specifically with the sort of the concept of impact. So this is basically why I'm here today. In this short time, I will try to say a few words about the impact culture. We have some specific activities, how we work with that at KTH, and also stress the importance that, you know, the grant office staff, specifically those working with Horizon Europe, how to be part of it, how I've been part of it in my day-to-day work. And also I will talk a little bit how we have worked with Horizon Europe and the concept of impact so far, what type of activities we've had. And also naturally, I will talk about the impact pathways in Horizon Europe and how we've been working with that specific concept with our researchers. So to start off with the impact culture and how you can basically see it at KTH and how we've been part of it, or myself, how I've been part of it and these activities. So it's really about different activities that have focus on impact. We have at KTH from 2012, there has been a research evaluation program, and part of that big sort of assessment, impact has always been a big part in this assessment. And there's a specific person also working with impact and this this sort of overreaching impact work, and it's obviously coordinated from the top in terms of the vice-rec president being very much involved in this work, having part of the steering group, and also obviously all the different schools at KTH. There is a designated impact leader who is responsible for the strategic work at the school. And obviously a communicator also connected, as impact communication is very important. So there's a communicator connected to the overall work that we are doing. And luckily also a research support office, specifically research or people working with European projects have had a role in that work as well. And that has been, not only it has been very good for me to learn more about impact work at our organization, but also in terms of feeding in the sort of the Horizon 2020 and Horizon Europe requirements, concepts, and so on. We have, from the Research Support Office, we work with researchers, as I said, also in terms of impact, not only in Horizon Europe context. We've developed something called Personal Impact Plan that we have presented for a long time also, to our researchers. It's basically formulated in different type of questions as a practical tool to help our researchers. We have a guide that is also part of that tool in order to help our research to write strong impact cases. We've had workshops and one-on-one meetings on with about this tool. And obviously the main selling point that we've used it for is to communicate to our researchers that you will be better prepared when calls on topics are announced in Horizon Europe already. And also this is a success, it's more likely to, you will be more likely to succeed in your research applications when you have already from the get-go considered impact. This is a little few slides from this PIP that we've done with our researchers. You can see very main questions on impact. We talk about the value chain, obviously the lead user, the end user, how you can broaden the reach of your impact. And obviously there's also some discussions or exercises that researchers have been able to do. And obviously a very important part is that that on sort of in the from the leading group or that it's defined on high level that impact is important. For example, at KTH we have a KTH Horizon Europe strategy that has been formulated in cooperation with our researchers, what they want to see as support measures at KTH when they are thinking about this new framework program. And obviously there's a specific section on the importance of impact in Horizon Europe. It's in Swedish, but I can just quickly take you through it. That there will be specific support measures to work with impact. And obviously that this is also connected in the impact work on the larger scale that we are doing at KTH then. One of the also sort of a low-hanging fruit or very good sort of support for myself when I've been working with impact with our researchers is this specific book, Research Impact Handbook, created by Marcus Reed, who is Director of Engagement and Impact at Newcastle University. There's also a very good website where and blog, and he's doing videos as well, I think podcast as well, about research impact. And it has been a very valuable book that I've been using in my work and also referring to, not only to my colleagues, but also to our researchers. So a little bit about impact as part of proposals and what type of activities we've done in order to make sure that it's focused in applications. So basically we're working a lot with the main messages, why impact is important. Obviously, as I mentioned previously, to make sure that the researcher knows that you will be more likely to succeed in competitive calls for funding, obviously not only Horizon Europe, but also in other type of funding calls for external research funding. It's always good to be very concise on what impact is. And also obviously to make sure that the support activities that you have, that those are well put forward, and also to make sure that you stress that you, as a research support office person, that you do have the knowledge and ability to support the research. And one part of that is actually the fact that when you are involved in this impact type of work on the school level. This is probably a lot of my colleagues know, Robert S. Porter, well known from EARMA conferences as well. I've always sort of went back to this this definition that he has put forward when it comes to specifically impact writing and proposal, to make sure that the researchers are aware how different it is from academic writing and how it should be sort of formulated. What we've done, we've had offered in-house seminars. We have offered seminars on social media in enhancing impact, sort of lunch and learn type of activity. We have had seminars on stakeholder engagement, on exploitation, dissemination, and communication. And also upcoming, we have a seminar based on the Horizon Europe template, where we have different sections for each excellent impact and implementation. And also, obviously, we've had a specific workshop on impact. For example, when a researcher already knows a specific topic or call that they will send their proposal to. So we've gathered for a researcher and a few of the other partners, mainly or specifically very helpful if the impact partners is part of that consortium already. So we've offered the workshop on impact, and obviously a lot of discussions one-on-one with the researchers about impact. This is just a few of the agendas from these activities. Also, we've been very lucky to have other organizations coming to KTH and talk about impact, and this work obviously continues as we move on further in the Horizon Europe. And obviously there's always a point in having specific exercises also with researchers when it comes to impact writing. And these two, for example, are just from the previous workshop that I've done on impact. And also, it's always good to join forces. We've had a specific event with UCL and as well as the universities from the Stockholm region. Obviously, this is this workshop was a part of a sort of policy aspiration from a regional level, which sort of trickled down in Horizon Europe. But I very much like this approach, and also being able to put forward impact in these events. So a little bit more about impact pathways, if I have the time. Yes. So just a few ideas on how to make sure that researchers are on board, what it means, this concept of impact pathways, our main messages, and some of the tips and tools that we have used. So obviously, we always start off with talking about, as you all know, the importance to understand that it's a policy instrument, Horizon Europe, where we work with a specific problem defined by the European Commission with member states when it comes out as an open call, and finally, the product then being the solution, the project proposal with the researcher and the consortium. And when we talk about impact, so we usually define or refer obviously to the strategic plan of Horizon Europe and obviously the work programs with destinations and expected outcomes. So we usually remind our researchers about the two levels of impact that you can sort of find as the defining Horizon Europe program, the expected impacts in the destinations, and the expected outcomes in the topics. And just to make sure that the researchers understand these two levels, what they where they stem from, and what type of concrete activities they refer to. And obviously, it's also in the call for proposals, you find the same as you all know. We go back, obviously, when we talk about the resource that give specific, these are obviously commission slides, but you know, we have our own slides as well on these type of activities. We talk about the specific resource, what it is, what it can be. And we talk a lot about expected outcomes. And this term has, as I've experienced, can be quite challenging. It's good to be very clear with the researchers what it means. It's not about results, it's more about enabling systemic changes, how it's different from the impacts that the Commission is talking about, as in terms that is shortly after the project or during, and obviously making sure that it's defined in the context and aligned with that. And many times we've had the sort of the problem of defining sort of the timeline for expected impacts, when expected outcomes should be stemming from a project. One of my Danish colleagues actually very nicely described a expected outcome as a bus stop, a possibility engaging the stakeholders on your way to a destination. And this sort of example, I found it very useful when talking about expected outcomes with the researchers. Obviously, you cannot escape from the policy backgrounds that also need to be elaborated. Usually you get the question from researchers that how much policy documents do I have to read through, how much of the policies do I have to be aware of. We usually refer to at least the Horizon Europe Strategic Plan. It's a very good document. It's short, concise, and has all the main elements to be aware of. And obviously these, as you know, the four key strategic orientations for greater impact. When it comes to pathway to impact, this is...
I'm very sorry to interrupt you, just reminding that you have few seconds, very few.
Perfect, very good. So this is the pathway to impact that we work with our researchers. And finally, obviously, as more concrete examples that you have, that the better. Commission is good on giving also these type of concrete examples. Best, obviously, if you can take them out of from your organizations. One thing that has proven very, very important also to make sure that the researchers understand the difference between communication, dissemination, and exploitation, and always coming back to that. We remind of the impact evaluation criteria, specifically the terming of scale and significance, that they understand the what the scale means, the how widespread the outcomes and impact are likely to be, and the significance on the sort of the importance or the value of these benefits. And we go also back into specific thoughts on what the evaluators are waiting in terms of the impact. These are a few. You will get these slides, so you will find more information. We are also working a lot with the previously mentioned Marcus Reed, with rather good tables when it comes to stakeholder mapping and taking stakeholder mapping into impact. Obviously, as you know, many colleagues work with other type of tools, logical framework approach. I think it was also mentioned previously in the EARMA event that a lot of our colleagues work with that. And obviously, there's the impact canvas that also is a very, very good tool when working with impact. So sorry about, I tried to be as fast as I could. hopefully.
Thank you very much, Anna. I think all of us would be glad to listen more and learn more about this topic because it is of crucial importance. However, unfortunately, we are very much limited in time. So let me just read out the two questions that I received, and if you could have an answer in one sentence, it would be highly appreciated.
I will try. So,
the first one is from Sven, and he asks whether you would be willing to share the impact cases, a practical help document that you have produced. It would be very valuable and of great inspiration.
I think that would be possible. Please do contact me separately so I can talk more about that and maybe be able to share some parts of it at least.
Perfect. Thank you for your willingness. And another from Edwin, who asks whether you would say that in your workshops, things change from Horizon 2020 to Horizon Europe, or is impact still impact?
I would say that it's more about being confused on a higher level when it comes to impact. Now, Commission is very amended of giving examples and explanations on what they are looking for, but sometimes it makes it even harder to sort of define the impact. As I've experienced it, impact is still impact, now with a sort of a sugar coating on top of it. If that's a good answer.
Of course. Thank you very much, Anna. It was very nice to have you here again. And thank you for this very nice presentation and all the details. Now I will give the floor to Daniel Spichtinger, who is working as an independent consultant on EU research policy and open science. He is also employed at the Ludwig Boltzmann Gesellschaft in their grants office and has carried out a wonderful study on data management plans and so on and so forth. Daniel, you will have 15 minutes for your presentation again, and then I will open the floor for the questions. So please go ahead.
So thank you very much for the kind introduction. So I will try to share my slides, just a moment. Let's see if that works. I think by now we are all very well aware how Zoom works, but you never know. Can you see the slides?
Yes, it works fine.
Excellent. So thank you for the introduction. So I can actually already jump over the first slide, which is just about myself. And I'm going to talk about in my presentation, a new tool for open access that the European Commission has supported. So it's run by a company called F1000 on behalf of the European Commission. But just to clarify, so my perspective in that, on the one hand, is the policy perspective, but specifically also that I was involved in a research project and we decided to publish in Open Research Europe. And since, you know, it's still a fairly new service, that's, I think, why I also got asked to say a little bit from that perspective. But just to be clear that I'm not employed by F1000, neither by the European Commission. I was for 6 years, but now I'm back in Vienna and no longer with the Commission. So it's not an official position of either the Commission or F1000. Still, I think it's good to start with a little introduction. So I did use some of the slides from the Commission fact sheet. So why and, you know, what is Open Research Europe? So the idea is to provide a scientifically rigorous public service for researchers, but not any researchers, but researchers specifically that have a grant from the Horizon program. So Horizon 2020 and Horizon Europe. Since also, as you might know, open access is an obligation in Horizon. I think there was the willingness and also the need that one should support also researchers, you know, so not just demand something, but also provide some support tools. And Open Research Europe is that? But I think it's also very, very important, just not to give any wrong impression, that this service is entirely optional and voluntary. So the commission is certainly not telling researchers where to publish, yeah? But this is just one of the possibilities of for researchers to provide open access and at the same time, of course, comply with the Horizon obligation. And one of the things that, you know, also at my time when I was still at the commission, we sometimes heard, because I was kind of dealing with open access there, yes, this open access, oh, but it's also, it costs so much money. And, you know, that might certainly be true for some journals, especially so-called hybrid journals, but this system is available at no cost to the research. So it's a public procurement. So the commission, of course, pays F1000 to run this service, but researchers themselves do not have to pay to publish. So no article processing fees. How does it work? And you know, this is also the process that I went through when I published the article. So we are starting from article submission and then the publication of a preprint. So this service, it tries to be, and I think it is, innovative. So we are actually combining open access publications with two other important open science aspects. So open science being a little bit the umbrella term for all sorts of open practices. And one of them is preprints, and the other one is open peer review. So first of all, you submit the article and it goes through a basic check. And, you know, I will show you what that looked like in my case. And once this basic check is done, it's already published in the Open Research Europe portal at Open Research Europe website. And then the peer review process starts. And they're trying to get at least three peer reviews, two of which have to be approved or approved with preservation. And you can see that, right? So you can see what the peer reviewers wrote and also what their judgment was. And after that, it's actually, as an author, of course, you have the chance to do a new version. So for me, for several reasons, because the project I was working on for this article is over, I'm still working on the new version of the article. So peer review is in, but I'm hoping to finally be able to publish a new version quite soon. So that's kind of the very basic approach. So as I've said, it was implemented through a public procurement contract. And as I've said, it's still quite a new service, right? It went live on the 24th of March, 2021. And they celebrated already their 100th article on the 14th of September. So you might be interested. Here you can see a little bit what kind of fields these articles were published in. And I just checked back. That's actually not correct, sorry. I actually just checked back recently about how many articles there are at the moment. So there are at the moment 164 articles, but it's not of 14th October, but that was a couple of days ago. So it is growing, and you can see that in the next slide. This is just my own not very sophisticated slide about the growth of the articles. So you do see quite some growth. Here is my case. So I was actually involved in a study about data management plans. And we did a survey of Horizon 2020 beneficiaries to ask them, you know, how did they cope with data management plans? And then we decided, okay, let's publish that at Open Research Europe. And you can see here, it's the first version, as I've said, peer review is complete, but my implementation of it not yet. And you can see two approved and one approved with reservations. So you have here these two checks and one question mark. And you can also actually read what the reviewers have said. So, you know, if you're curious why reviewer three only approved it with reservations, you can have a look at that. And you can also see who that was. By the way, I think these were, my only impression was that these were all very relevant comments. in the peer review. So I'll try my best to include it in the next version. Because I was asked also to share what my own experiences were, I will give you a quick here timeline of how the system worked with me for the first phase. So already for the phase and when you submit it to the phase when it's published as a preprint, so before the peer review, because I think it's also quite important to stress that, you know, they just, it's not that they just put this on and then they pass it on, but already that there is quite some feedback loops before the peer review, before the preprint goes online, so before the peer review. So I sent it in on end of February last year. And I got some feedback middle of March with a questions about what was the ethic approval process for the study and the data license. So there's also the need to provide the underlying data with a CC BY license, but quite restricted. The CC BY license is the only one allowed, and I had a CC BY share alike, so I had to change that. Then I did that. That was then on the 1st of April, I got some further things to do. Namely, we did a language check and edits. I need to replace some of the tables because, you know, the quality wasn't good enough. The underlying data was checked. The acknowledgements, I had to provide statement that everybody's fine, that I acknowledge them. So the people, you know, that commissioned the study was part of open air. Consent of the interview for the interviews. We didn't only do a survey, we also did interviews, was checked. And then Open Research Europe asked me to invite, to provide suggestions for up to 5 reviewers in their online tool. So you can suggest in a way who should review it, but first of all, they are not obliged to follow that. They can suggest their own reviewers. And also some of the reviewers that I suggested were rejected. So that was middle of April. Then 8th of April, I got some further feedback regarding the underlying data, some further follow-up questions on the consent. Then I could show that I changed the license. And middle of April, the article was accepted for preprint. So a bit 1.5 months, I would say, for this initial process. And then end of April, they actually was published as a preprint after the final checks. And then the whole peer review process started. And the peer review process in itself then took quite long. So that was a bit longer than I expected, I have to say. But also because, of course, peer review in itself, you know, need to chase the reviewers and so on. So what were my impressions? My first impression was that these pre-checks, so what I just described to you before the preprint is published, that was fairly swift and also well-informed. And that it also put in, you know, some checks and barriers to ensure that already the preprint has a certain quality as concerns, for instance, also the underlying data and so on. Second impression is the peer reviewers. And for the peer reviewers, so you could suggest your own, or you could also make use of an automatic tool that they have, that they say, oh, this tool will suggest appropriate reviewers. And here with this tool, I wasn't that keen on it, and it didn't actually provide that good results, because the database of reviewers, that was very much, at least that was my impression, for my topic, it was very much skewed towards the medical field and the natural sciences, but specifically the medical field. So this tool suggested some reviewers which have published about consent forms in medical research, but the paper was about data management plans, so far more broader. So this tool, at least at the time, there was room for improvement, I think. And I've said the peer review did take quite a couple of months, but that being said, it's I think still faster than in many traditional journals. What I also want to stress, in my case, you know, the peer review, I got two checks and one question mark, so go ahead. But the positive peer review is not a given. So you can also find some articles on Open Research Europe, which are only available as preprints. And you know, if you look at the peer review section, so this is one example that I looked for and found also because it's close to my interest, which was basically two crosses, right? So two red crosses means both peer reviewers were saying, okay, you know, this has quite a few weaknesses and we cannot approve publication as it is. And you can read also what these were and whether you agree with them, right? So I think they were a bit harsh there, but of course not my call to make. So just, you know, sometimes there's also this feeling, okay, if I pay, well, you don't pay, but if it's a paid service, okay, maybe they just publish everything, you know? But I do think that the peer review is quite rigorous. Last but not least, because, you know, I have my two hats, so I used to work a lot with researchers that are submitting proposals, and also I'm already still now doing that again. But of course, I'm still also interested in policy. So from the policy side, Open Research Europe is part of the European Research Area. So it gets mentioned in this communication from the Commission on the new research era, right? Area. So this idea to reform the era. And it was interesting for me to see that it gets a mention there. And, you know, of course, it's nice because the Commission can say, oh, we ticked that box. Yeah, we already launched this service. But at the moment, it's only for Horizon grantees. And so in what sense is this part of the era? Except that Horizon as such, of course, is linked to the era. So my suggestion policy-wise would be that it would be very interesting if national funders could join this service as well, because it exists, you know, it's running, it's been set up. And I think it would be nice if national funders maybe would also pay in, right? And then that grantees from national funders, so like in Austria, for instance, the FVF, could have the possibility to also use this service. So it would be a nice synergy, I would say. And one of the things that I didn't mention is that there are some funders who already have this service as well. So the Wellcome Trust in the UK actually started this whole idea. And it was a little bit also, I think, an inspiration for starting with Open Research Europe. So looking at the time, how are we doing?
Sorry for interrupting you, just saying that we have very few seconds more. And then I have to
We have what?
We are just ending your presentation. So please feel free to end it.
Okay.
And then we have to turn to the questions.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm already, that was what I was asking. I'm at the end of the presentation and there are my contact details here. In my capacity as an independent researcher, as I've said, I'm also employed by Ludwig Boltzmann, but that was kind of an independent research I did. So it was a quick run through the system, but I'm happy, of course, to take questions. So citation, I see there's one question.
Yeah, there is even more.
Oh, there are more questions.
Christina.
There we go.
So Christina,
how many times do we have? How much time do we have for the questions?
One answer for each question. one sentence long answer.
11:10. Okay. So
is there any possibility to apply to be peer reviewer for ORE?
That's a very good question, to be honest. I don't know. You would need to check the website.
Okay, we will check it. Thank
you.
So
the second question. No, they didn't take the reviewers from the reviewer tool because I said it's not appropriate. So they took them from the list of reviewers that I provided. And some of them, I provided them with quite a number. Some of them they rejected, but at least three of them, they said, okay, they look good, we'll take those. How do citations work? Like in any paper, yeah? It's really like a normal paper. So citations like in any paper. do you need to register into the OLE platform to be a reviewer? So no, you don't need, because, you know, in the first case, it's the offer that can suggest these reviewers. And none of the reviewers that I suggested were in this database, because I think the database is still quite limited to the medical field. So then I provided them with the contact details. I had to research them myself, to be honest, a little bit. And so then they contact them. I think I provided them 7-8 names and they chose 3 of them. And then they contact, of course, I don't contact the reviewers, but I give them the names, they contact the reviewers and ask them whether they would be willing to do it.
Thank you a lot. And there was also one question a bit earlier. Christina asked whether there is any plan to expand the ORA beyond the results of the EC funded project.
I think that's what you need to ask the commission, because they are paying for it. And, you know, I'm no longer part of the commission. I think it would be a very good idea if they would. But unfortunately, that's not up to me.
Thank you a lot, Dania, for sharing your first experiences.
Thank you very much.
Well, they are very useful. And thank you for also joining us.